Good evening. Welcome to the Wednesday, January 11th, 2017 meeting of the school committee. At this time, we'd ask that you stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Please have a seat. This time, I'd ask we observe a moment of silence for our troops serving overseas. Thank you and good evening. Madam Vice Chair.
Good evening, Superintendent. Happy New Year.
You'll be running the meeting for now. Is that okay?
That's fine with me.
Good evening to all our school committee members.
Good evening.
We'd like to begin with a short video on the turf that has been replaced at Lawrence High School. As you know, we had an unfortunate incident where the turf was destroyed. Folks did a great job coming together and getting it back in place for the Thanksgiving Day game. And this is just a time-lapse video. I don't think there's even sound, but people can see the work that was done in a very short amount of time. So thank you to everyone that was involved. It is a beautiful turf field, one of the best that I've seen probably in the state at this point. We do anticipate that the track will be redone after the season in the spring, early summer, and we will provide you more information as that becomes available.
Thank you.
Without further ado, Madam Vice Chair, I'd like to ask Mr. Fiato and Ms. Snyder to come up and talk about the high school internship program and the direction they're going.
Please. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So last year, the Lawrence Working Families Initiative looked at an urban agenda grant from the state and realized that we had a great opportunity to expand working families and that concept to raise awareness with our high school students around career opportunities, that would equal a longer range sustainability for economic sustainability plan for our students. To that end, we received the award, and this was one of the initiatives we applied money towards. Mr. Fiato partnered with the initiative, and we were able in the pilot this past fall to be able to offer up to 20 students opportunities with various employers throughout Lawrence. It was a really interesting pilot so far, which we hope to expand even this spring and beyond. And we learned some really interesting lessons from it. There's a video we're going to show you in a moment that demonstrates a lot of the successes. We've also learned a lot of things around our soft skills training at the front end, around fit, around communication with students, on what it means to be in an internship versus a job. It's been a really exciting fall, I think. Do you want to add to that before we?
Sure. So as we look at the high school redesign, we want to ensure that our students are college and career ready. One major part of that experience would be providing students with real world opportunities outside of the classroom in programs such as this, as we embarked on our really first ever really formalized internship program. So we plan on, we had about 15 students in the first semester in the first pilot, and we're gonna double that. So all 15 students will remain in the second semester and will continue on from first semester to second, so that's great. We may be shifting some of the students to different places. They range in locations, partners with nonprofits, for-profits, business, engineering, healthcare. Those are some of our biggest internship sites. So as we look at the high school redesign, the internship program will continue to be a really important part of the high school redesign to ensure that our students get those real-world experiences during the school day.
Great. So this is a four-minute video about the program.
Past the internship program didn't necessarily have any partnerships within the community. It was more or less internships within the school. This year we wanted to kind of branch out and give the kids a real college and career readiness experience.
Valley Works Career Center, as part of the Lawrence Working Families Initiative, was asked to come in and support Lawrence High School with its new idea of having an internship program for some of its seniors. It became clear to our partners that the Career Center was in really a very good place to use our relationships that are already in place with businesses in the Lawrence community to then support this idea of adding young high school interns. We're down to about 12 very steady students who are working in a variety of settings in our community with both nonprofit businesses but also for-profit businesses.
The largest component is making sure you're accountable, your attendance, your professionalism at the workplace, your communication skills, soft skills. That's what we tried building in early on in the program. There was a two-week orientation.
We did what we call a work-based learning plan workshop with them, where we talked about those areas that employers are looking for, punctuality, attendance, attitude, professional dress, what do you do if you're sick or if you have a transportation, calling, being responsible.
It could kind of either be something that they can want to jump into later on, and it can also be a reality to them and say, maybe this isn't the field I want. So I think it's just giving them the visibility to what the real world might have for them.
I'm the owner of Brushstroke Sign Design. We do all kinds of signs. We do awnings, banners, vehicle lettering, window lettering.
I think it's great for the students because they can see in the real world how it works, how they can apply their skills. He helps me out up here too. It's great because sometimes I need a hand, and he's right there. He's focused. He's learning. I could tell that he's very eager to learn. It's hard to get a job nowadays, so when they're in the industry and they see it, I think it just makes them want to learn more.
Being here is providing her work experience, especially in an office setting. It is also an opportunity for her to learn more about city government and getting involved as well with customer service.
And you're enjoying the experience?
Yes, I am.
Elevated Thought, art and social justice nonprofit focused here in Lawrence. I'm fortunate enough to have this young lady, Celeste Cruz, as an Elevated Thought youth leader and intern. Right now she's back there getting a project ready for an exhibit we're having, exhibit/food drive in collaboration with Bread and Roses. You know, she's gearing up to start to help me plan for the fall and winter curriculums in our Creative Community Change program as well.
Northeast Legal Aid is a nonprofit organization that provides no-cost legal assistance to low-income and elderly people throughout Northern Middlesex and Essex counties. It's been so easy having an LHS intern here, and it's actually been really helpful.
They've done some media assignments for me, for everything from finding relevant contracts, finding customer agreements, so they've been very helpful.
We are an organization that is committed to changing places and changing lives by improving places around Lawrence, such as improving our park system and committing to programming to develop healthy food systems. And we're also committed to education. We have a reputation for our big and large events, such as our Speaker River Cleanup, our Comcast Earth Day, and that there's a lot of work that goes behind that. Mariah was ready to go on day one, and when we think about what matters to groundwork, that's the groundwork way.
They taught me before I started anything, so they would go over everything with me so I know what to do. It feels like a real job. I have to get my transportation here and back home. I would recommend this program to others because I find it very interesting and fun.
From where we started, I feel like we've built a good foundation and something to build off of, and I think the numbers will only increase as the program continues to grow.
know if you have any questions for us.
I have a question. What year are the students in high school?
They're all seniors.
They're all seniors. And is there an opportunity for them to continue, like, with summer employment at these different places? Or is it just a internship and then that's it?
I think that's the hope, that the employer, through the internship program, will notice them and provide them with some opportunities. So those are, we're in discussions with that, but there are no formal agreements that the employer has to retain them for summer employment. But because we're working with Valley Works Lawrence, and they're the partner that provides the internship opportunities, these students will have, I think, an upper hand to be able to secure a summer employment because they're already working closely with Valley Works.
And I know you alluded to the fact that now with the high school redesign, you're going to look at your programs and try to match them with the real life. Did I understand that, real life
yes.
experiences? Okay, thank you.
Mr. Castaneda?
I was just wondering how the students got to their job site.
We feel it's very important that at this point in the student's life that they have to make a commitment to figure out how to get from the school to the job site. So they employ a various range of transportation modes. Many of our students in Lawrence don't understand the bus schedule, so we taught them how to take the city bus. Some students have their own cars and are able to get either a ride from a family member or take their own car. And in some cases, the internships are within walking distance from the high school.
Thank you. I was also wondering how many hours a week or a month they were doing.
So it's approximately 4 to 5 hours a week.
Thank you.
Mr. Robles?
I just wanted to just comment on how awesome and vital, you know, a program like this is, you know, especially for the students at the high school. I just wish I had something like this, you know, previously for myself, but I totally miss the aspect of the Northeast Justice Center. What is their involvement with the internship? Do students just work within that department as far as pertaining to legal assistance, or can you just help me?
Every student that applies to be an intern at Lawrence High School fills out a student inventory,
okay.
And they illustrate or indicate which career fields they might be interested in.
Okay.
So for those students who indicated that they were interested in law or social justice,
sure.
They got matched up with that organization. But we have other students, as you saw, that were in either graphic illustration or with the mayor's office working in working on politics and community relations.
Nice.
So depending on the student's interest, we wanted to match. We felt we'd have a lot higher success rate if they were matched up with the industry or a career field that they were interested in.
Very good. Thank you.
I will say that our experience was great. Nothing against us college students. We always have a special class of college students, but our high school intern from Lawrence High School was better than some of the college students.
Yay.
So we're looking forward to another staff. And we had a policy before, we didn't do high school students, but this is great.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, moving right along, we want to talk about enrollment projections. Again, Denise Snyder from the Family Welcome Center is here to talk about the growing enrollment and the strain that that's putting on our schools with different possibilities in the future that we wanted to alert you of. Without further ado, Ms.
All
Snyder.
Right. Thank you again for the opportunity. First, I want to acknowledge Liz Young, our enrollment manager, who has worked very hard on this presentation with me, along with Adam Kischel, who does data analysis for us. Tonight, we're going to look at K-8 enrollment in particular as we prepare to address some capacity challenges that we believe are in front of us. So the first slide here you'll see is a glance of overall enrollment trends, in this case, pre-K to 12. You can see we've been on a continuous increase with the exception of 2015. And even that's a small dip, but the small dip is really attributed to our ninth grade class last year. The vocational school expanded their ninth grade capacity, and we learned to do a lot more marketing to keep our kids. And that's a little more evident this year in 2017 with the, again, continued increase. This does not include our LEAP program students. Those are the two community-based preschool programs that we have, which would add about another 135 children. But we're really dealing here with our school buildings and the capacity within our buildings. So if you turn to the next slide, this is a view of K to 8 specifically. And again, this is a continuous trend, growing enrollment. You'll see here a slight dip in this coming year, this year. And that is our kindergarten enrollment for the coming year is decreased. And pre-K and kindergarten are incredibly hard to project. We can't do birth rates, people move too much. It's a very transient city between moving in and out or around Lawrence that until they're ours, it's a little bit of a moving target that we use pre-K into kindergarten, but even then, those numbers, those seats don't match up, so there's a constant unknown. So that is the slight dip that you see there. However, as you can see overall, we continue to grow. So on this slide, this is just a nice illustration of the size of the cohorts. You'll see fifth grade is also a little small, so at some point that was a kindergarten class that also had a dip, and now it's made its way up to fifth grade. But primarily we have 1,100 or so kids in each one of our grades. So I'm going to take us to the next slide, which actually begins to show the challenges with growing enrollment, which typically is a really great thing, right? So in this slide, you're going to see this is our current enrollment hold document that we use at the Family Resource Center. Everything in yellow is a school that has at least one grade closed, meaning capacity is maximum and we cannot put another child in the classroom. The red indicates those grade levels that are closed. The green actually indicates we'd closed it previously, but had to reopen it because if we thought at one point that 25 kids may have been the maximum in first grade, but all the neighborhood schools reach 25, then we're gonna have to open it to let a 26th person in somewhere. So they were closed and have been reopened. So it gives you an idea that in essence, they should be red if they could be red. Let's see, so we're gonna use this information to project along with some other facts for next year. Wow, is that tiny. Fortunately, you have it in front of you. This is projected seat capacity issues for next year. When you look at this, everything in red indicates that we don't have enough seats for the grades at those schools. The redder the box, the more severe the problem. The pre-K and K, again, is not projected, so they're not on here, and we make assumptions about what's going to happen. So this is first through eighth grade, and what we are able to do in some instances is look at schools that do have capacity and shift the neighborhood boundaries as a way to adjust capacity. So for example, up Oliver and up Leonard, we were able to move the boundaries for those schools a little bit. And so next year, UPL will take on more of the sixth graders. At this point, as you can see, they've got a ton of open seats. And I want to go back and remind you that those blue bars indicated that fifth grade was small, so that fifth grade becomes sixth grade. That's why that number's so large. But in order to even that out, we will shift the boundaries. So that's a great example of how just moving a couple of streets over and assigning kids to the closer school on the other side solves that problem. We adjusted, or we will adjust boundaries for South Lawrence to deal with some of those issues where we have space at, say, South Lawrence East or Spark, and don't have it at Weatherby, for example. And similarly, some issues with Tower Hill we're able to do. The real challenges are right here in the central part of the city, right up through Arlington, where all of the schools are feeling basically the same crunch. So that's what we know. This slide is about what we don't know. What we've learned is that there are 7 new residences being built, coming online into Lawrence over the next 2 years. You'll see on the chart that you'll be able to look at units, how big those properties are. They range in size from 64 units to 250 units. And you can see when they plan to come online or go live with families living in them. The Union Crossing, for instance, will come online, should have come online at the end of December, but it's coming soon. People are actually signing leases for that now. You can also see the impact area. Almost all of these residences will impact where Oliver Partnership School is, UPO and UPL, and up into the Arlington area. So we have to take in consideration this variable that we can't actually identify. We know kids are going to live in those units. We're actually working with the mayor's office to figure out how many of those units are multiple bedrooms as a way to figure out if those might be families or singles. But even then, trying to figure out at this point, a year in advance, how old the kids are, we're basically going to instead be able to identify, and you see it on this slide.
Can we just go back to the other slide just real quick? To
you bet.
I think the important takeaway here is that there is going to be some more coming online.
Right.
The push has been from this administration to build 2 and 3 bedroom units to house, to deal with the current need that people living here have.
Yeah.
So if that helps you, that, you know, some of these are market rate housing. When I think of Pacific Mill Phase 3 and Pacific Mills Phase 1 and 2, those are market rate housing.
Mm-hmm.
Monarch Loft is going to be market rate housing.
Mm-hmm.
5 Frankly, Van Brody, and Union Crossing Phase 2, all of them are going to have moderate low-income housing.
Sure.
And so that's going to be more from people who are already living here. So the growth is really in 2 of the projects. And Newark, we're not really sure yet.
Yeah.
Okay. It's so early on Newark that I wouldn't be able to tell you any information on that one. So
right. Very helpful information. And I think that in all cases, we were assuming, even with Union Crossing, we reached out to Lawrence Community Works. And, you know, they said probably 60 to 80% would be residents who already live here, leaving 20 to 40% for, you know, possible new occupancy. I think the reality that we want to be thoughtful about is that there will be more children in that area of town, and maybe a few less somewhere else in town,
mm-hmm.
or maybe we will have freed up space in more affordable areas for more residents to come to Lawrence, right? So that continues to be a variable. So just something to look at. And what we did was try to think about, well, what if any fraction of these kids are new to this specific area of Lawrence, how should we address that? So when we look at the next slide, maybe. There we go. What we did here was give you a visual where you can see the little houses obviously represent where the new buildings are going to be built. And what we did was take our page 5 that had all of the yellow schools that had grades closed, and look at all of those ones that were either closed or on the verge of closing, like maybe, actually it was page 5 was the one with all the red squares, but anything that only had 1 or 2 remaining seats, and thought those seats could be eaten up by any new residences, and we should try and identify solutions for potential capacity issues there. So as you can see, again, I don't want to go on and on about this, but the issue still remains mostly in Central City around Oliver Partnership School and right up through the Arlington. So what we wanted to do at this point was share with you some of the solutions that we're considering to deal with what is really good news, but is still a problem, right? Still a challenge we have. So this clicker doesn't like me. Stay tuned. There we go. The Leahy. We didn't talk a lot about this, but right now the Leahy does not have enough seats at fourth grade, and in a year from now, that same problem will happen for fifth grade. However, the Lawler is under-enrolled for kindergarten, so we're going to move two classrooms worth, basically change boundaries to shift about 44 kindergarten students to go to the Lawler for kindergarten, which is already a kindergarten school. And then when they go to first grade, they would go back to the Leahy for first grade. So they will begin their experience with us at the Lawler and then move back to and move on to the Leahy. But that takes care of that issue. It's really simple, it's cost effective or cost neutral, in fact, and that will take care of that. Now, the next ones are a little more involved because they really do tackle the Oliver Partnership School. Pardon me?
It's okay.
Okay. Option one, we already have St. Mary's being leased. St. Mary's is being used for part of the Bruce School population while the school is being repaired from the fire, and it's prepped and ready to go. It would be easy to continue that lease for a set number of years, and it has roughly 12 classrooms, which would allow very nicely for a two-strand school. Could be a K to four, could be a K to five. We would have 44 additional kindergarten seats that can grow into the need that will come back again at us, and 50 additional seats for each of the other grades. The challenges, of course, are though they come with lease costs and administrative and staff costs. So that would be one of the solutions, possible solutions.
What's the current lease cost on that?
It's 17,000.
20,000 a month.
Which one is it?
A little less than 20,000 a month. I'd say 18.
I think we need new batteries.
It's not the up button.
Well, it keeps working. Sorry, my answer's wet.
Dave, you guys may need to move the slide up or change batteries on this. Can you move the next slide?
There we go. All right, so the second option is that you went one too many. Can you go back one? General Donovan School is a school that we had used formerly. It's been offline in terms of a school building for us for a while, but we could look at bringing that back online. That has 8 classrooms, so it would have to be a single strand school in order to have enough classrooms in it for interventions and specials or anything like that. But it's a viable option. The challenges, of course, that would have to be weighed are the repair costs, the timeline, the fact that I think that there are some folks using it now, so that might displace some folks. Again, same administrative and staffing costs in terms of getting it up and running. And again, not as much capacity as the St. Mary's, but certainly an option to be considered. And then in the third option, Dave, if you would just, you did, as the modulars, right? Lots of folks are familiar with modulars. They're used frequently in these types of challenges, but they have tons of consequences. There are lease options, lease costs, of course, but it's not a great experience for the kids who are in the modular. Like, who gets to go to the modular? Who gets to go outside to go back in the building for lunch? I've never heard from anyone who had an awesome experience in the modular. But people do use them. Bigger challenge would be where you would put them. When you look at the schools who would really need them, they'd have to give up their playground or something of the equivalent. And again, you'd be compromising sort of the quality experience of kids, which, you know, is something that I think we're all really proud of. So again, though, no stone left unturned. It is an option that we're going to have to look at. So with that said, those are the three proposals that we've come up with to date. We're interested in hearing people's ideas. We're certainly going to be looking very closely at what the cost factors are, you know, how quickly it takes to make the shift, what grades are needed first, et cetera. I do want to close with just a final slide on the high school campus enrollment, just to acknowledge that I showed you before that in 2015 we had a bit of a dip for ninth grade, and we've recovered from that, and again, we have the outstanding challenge of lots of kids coming to our schools, and what do we do with them? So this is a enrollment figure that we're just going to keep monitoring as we think about how to continue to have a great high school experience and an even better experience. So we'll be monitoring the patterns for enrollment with that.
Any questions from the group?
So you're thinking, I saw a bunch of suggestions about the K through eight, but I didn't see any, so you don't think there's a need for dealing with the amount of enrollment in the high school at this moment?
No, I think, you know, what we came today to address is the K to eight space, but we put the last school on at the high school, which is bursting at the seams, in my opinion, and has over 3,200 kids. And I think that Mr. Fiato and I will be coming back to you later in the spring with possibilities for how to fix that.
So, and we have one application in to rebuild the Oliver. And is that factored into this, like the process, you know?
Well, I think, you know, we have not heard back. That's a competitive grant. We're not sure if we're going to get it. But even if we do get it, by the time that ground is broken and the new building is built, we're probably looking at 4 to 5 years out. So what we've done, I guess, in the big picture, Mayor, is kind of make the slight boundary changes that were needed every year to try to make everything fit. We are here today to kind of say we're kind of running out of room, as you know. We have put in a lot of work on maintenance. We have put in a proposal with the MSBA. I think we're going to do another one this year and just keep them in the pipeline, because I think based on the enrollment, we're going to keep having to apply for new buildings to be built. With that said, with all of these new complexes coming on, we are hoping indeed that a lot of this is in-town transfers, or at the buildings that are being built by the railroad station, young professionals who don't necessarily have children but want to be close to the T to get into Boston coming in, because typically the rule of thumb is, you know, two children for every unit. And if you do the math there, that would be a tremendous amount of children coming into the district. So we're going to be prepared for all contingencies, but
it's a work in progress. So my question was basically, there's a high possibility that we're going to get this the Oliver rebuilt, and in that conversation, is there programming that you've seen that could, instead of, I don't know, I think it's a 3-floor building now, to go into 5 floors or a 6-floor building, given the need in that area, and what does that look like for a school experience for K through 8? I mean, it seems like...
So I think if we do get approved, then we go to the next phase with the MSBA, and they allow us to kind of spec out design possibilities, and that may be a building that could double or triple in size, depending on what you do, to be able to account for a lot of the need in the middle of the city. So I think, you know, obviously we have to get through that hurdle of being accepted, but I think there is a great opportunity for us to weigh in on what type of building we want, how many floors, how many kids, et cetera.
I guess
and one last thing, Mr. Mayor, before I forget, I mean, the Donovan, and I'll have to check the regs because I haven't in the last couple of years, but it used to be that when a building was offline for so many years, if you brought it back to life as a school, you had to bring it back up to code in the current year.
Yeah.
So to bring that building, which is a much older building, back up to code could be a multi-million dollar adventure.
Right. If I can add the St. Mary's property, you know, I think our thoughts are also that it would be a long-term temporary, because, you know, the hope is that Oliver Partnership School would renovate and expand, right? So it's a temporary solution, knowing that, or hoping that in the long term, we're going to see a lot more capacity.
And I guess the last thing before I take questions is, I think that given the situation that the lease at the St. Mary's does seem like the best route, it just has to be packaged into the annual budget. I know the Phoenix is kind of come offline, and we're going to have to pick up the money on Phoenix next year.
Could have been this year.
I know we would have been.
Mr. Mayor.
We're just so happy.
We are happy.
But that being said, so we know that that's going to come offline. But if there's not capacity in the Chapter 70 dollars to do that with, then we'll just have to figure out how to get it done.
Yeah, we're going to work to figure it out, Mayor. I think, you know, we have tried to create swing space with us moving back to Essex Street. That will create room here. But even with that, there's got to be a short-term plan and a long-term plan.
And I don't know how people feel about modules, but I think that's just, I mean, I can see how that might work on with a high school setting, but maybe and not at K-8. Mrs. Mariano.
Yep, the superintendent just stated what I was going to ask. Essex Street, what's the projection with Essex Street and central office going back?
My understanding is over the summer, but I'll defer to the mayor who controls the buildings.
Yeah, I think that we're working now with the Workforce Investment Board and the Career Center. They should be in, they're gonna start moving in February 1, and then we're gonna switch all gears to prepare the other side for the school building. For the school department, and in talking with Chris and Anne-Marie, you know, soon thereafter when we get that site built out, what we have done right now is that we have a brand new roof on the building, a brand new HVAC system just went in. We have to do some stuff, which means heat and controlled heat and controlled AC, and we have some work to do on some windows and some we have brand new paint, some of that stuff. The elevators are all working. All the big ticket items have been taken care of. But I think because of the way the school system calendar is, that summer seems like the best time to get back in.
So as a follow-up, how many classrooms would be available in this building? Would that be able to support the overflow in the North Common area?
Yeah, I mean, we're looking at all possibilities as this is a swing space for next year, and I don't want to exclude the high school from the possibility. You know, all K through 12 seats are possible here. We've got to figure it out. I mean,
but just off, you know, I'm not holding.
How many classrooms do you think?
How many classrooms would be available here?
I want to say 16 to 20.
All right, so that's, you know, you're looking at St. Mary's, it's 12.
Yeah.
If you have 16 to 20 here.
Yeah, that would include like small offices. You know what I mean?
Oh, okay.
If actual classrooms, I'd say 12 to 16.
All right. And also, I know I've sent you an email, Jeff, and the mayor knows this, that the Rocky Club across from the Leahy School is for sale. And that's a nice piece of property that will be available that could be used for that school.
Okay.
Down the road.
We'll definitely check that out.
Cool. Mrs. Rivera? Ms. Rivera?
Have you considered or thought about reaching out to the local early intervention agencies in terms of trying to get projected numbers for incoming students with special needs? Because I know that other neighboring towns, they request information in terms of which kids are about to turn 3 and aging out of EI and about to come into preschool. Have you thought about doing
No, we do. We do. We definitely do. I think what we know is we know a certain threshold of kids that we're going to get. It's the difference in between of who we don't know we're going to get. So we've been partnering with the Head Start, early intervention, with the state to get the list of kids in programs who live in Lawrence. So we know those kids. We can say, all right, let's just assume, you know, 85 or 90% of them are coming to LPS. It's who's not in a program that's licensed that we don't know about. And so that's where our variable really remains.
I know that some of the, especially the special needs classrooms, tend to be at capacity or even borderline over capacity. Are there plans to expand classrooms for them as well?
It's a constant. Any time that, you know, we have an obligation to serve all students at 2.9, and when we reach a certain capacity, we do start looking around to see where we're going to open. It's also one of the reasons, I think, that Lawrence hasn't been able to seriously consider full-day pre-K, because we need that many seats in the district
to meet the needs for our children with disabilities and special needs.
I guess my concern is in being at IEP meetings, I hear, that classroom's full. We're not sure where to place that student. This is in the middle of the school year. Mm-hmm. So, what are you doing in terms of like the current moment when a classroom is full and there's no more room for placement? What are you doing to expand the classrooms for our special needs students?
I might defer to Dr. Bergeron on this. Special ed places, it's students, but I do know that we work awfully hard to meet the needs of all the kids.
Good. Ms. Castaneda?
Would you like to talk to her offline? You want her to come up? Whatever works.
I'm sorry. I missed it.
As we come to capacity, we've been looking at resources for opening additional classrooms. We have two classrooms in the district currently within current schools. Because of their K numbers being so low, there's capacity to open additional classrooms at this point in the time as we start to see the needs.
Where are those classrooms, the two classrooms?
I'd rather not say until we've worked it out with the principals, but we have been talking with them, but until it's been communicated back and forth, I don't want to publicly put those schools up.
Okay, so it hasn't been addressed officially yet,
we've had preliminary conversations with them, because we know we're coming up on the cap now.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Castaneda?
My question was already answered, but I have another question. Would it be more expensive to renovate, like you said, the Donovan, be a multi-million dollar project? Would it be more expensive to do that or to purchase a new, not new, but a building that's already standing and repurpose it? On average.
To renovate a current building?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's the same laws apply, right? So I see what you're saying. Our current buildings that are online are all kind of at or near capacity. So, I mean, there's a possibility about building a wing onto it, but when you do that, you have to go to the MSBA. Is that what you mean?
No, I'm
asking about acquiring a new property versus rehabbing the Donovan.
Yeah, we're gonna have to do some research on that, but it may be that other buildings that could be acquired or purchased are up to code or code eligible. Just say that the difference is when the city from buying a new building, you have to pay for it outright versus when you get the MSBA involved and the state pays 80 to 90% of the cost of the building. So it's obviously a great debt relief to the city as a whole to go with the MSBA than to be out there purchasing other buildings.
Thank you.
But the mayor seems in a generous mood tonight. He might be willing to buy, I don't know.
It's funny because this is going to sound like I'm being generous too, but don't take it the wrong way. We do own the old Holy Rosary School, and the community has had a lot of conversation about that building in and around the North Common, and people want to see this back as a learning institution of some sort. And so if that's something that would help the ebbs and flows of this situation, it would definitely help that neighborhood. And if we're talking about having a conversation with MSBA about what that might cost us, or does the city bite the bullet on it and just figure out a way to get it done? But I'm just not sure that anybody knows how much it would cost to put this up to current standards, and then what the net space is actually going to be
right
when you bring it up to net standards, because it is a beautiful building from the outside, but it's a small building.
Okay.
Thank you.
As folks know, we usually talk about newcomer and access testing later in the spring, but our ELL director, Ms. Foley, has decided that she's gonna have a baby later in the spring, so we asked her to come now. So please come. She's gonna talk not just about the testing, but also a program that she's launching to help get some of our paraprofessionals certified to be teachers to continue our pipeline.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
So I'm going to first talk a little bit. Let's see if the clicker will work for me. There we go. I'm going to talk about two things, as Jeff mentioned. The Access for L's 2.0 English Language Proficiency Test, and then Teach Next Year partnership with UMass Boston. So as many of you know, the Access for L's 2.0 test is a test that we've been taking since 2013. It replaced the MEPA. It's an English language proficiency assessment that all students in grades K through 12 take. The test is administered every year, unlike the other state exams that take place later in the spring. This test is happening right now, January, February, in all of our schools. And it helps schools and the district monitor the language development of our students. All students who are identified as English language learners take this test. And just as a point of reference, it takes a student about 4 to 7 years to achieve proficiency in English. Every student is different, but students are taking this test on average for 4 to 7 years until they exit our program. So the Access for L's test measures students' abilities to understand and produce English within the school setting. So we're really talking about academic language. They take the 4 sections of the test: a listening domain, speaking domain, reading domain, and writing domain. And they receive an individual score for each component of the test, as well as a few combined scores and an overall proficiency level. So go back one. Thanks. So again, who takes the test? All students in our district who are classified as an English language learner in grades K through 12 take the test until they reach the criteria to exit the program. In Lawrence, this means that annually about 32%, or a little over 4,500 students, are taking this test. So in some of our neighboring districts, low incidence districts, this might only impact one school or a handful of students. It's really impacting all of our schools, obviously, in a large population. The test scores are used in a lot of ways. They're shared with parents in a very parent-friendly manner, and they're able to use those scores to advocate for their students, see how their student is growing in English. Teachers use the scores to plan instruction for students. Schools use the scores to place students in the right services for them. And then as a district, we use it to kind of monitor how are we doing with our English language development programs that are in place. So how are we doing? And the answer is pretty well. I just summarized a little bit over the past 3 years. When we look at how are we doing on this test as a district, it is a little different from MCAS because it's structured differently and accountability looks different. But essentially, we're looking at two things. One is the percent of students who are making progress on the test. Okay, so we have 4,500 students. How many are actually showing growth on this assessment? And then attainment. So I mentioned that 4 to 7 year range to achieve English proficiency. We look at the percent of students who are actually achieving proficiency on the test. Over the past 3 years on the graph, you can see that we've seen consistent growth in both of these indicators. So 3 years ago in 2014, about 55% of our students were making progress or demonstrating growth. Last year, in 2016, 70% of our students were making growth. And percent of students achieving proficiency in 2014, you can see, was around 10%. That has doubled. In 2016, 20% of our students achieved proficiency on this state exam. Okay. And I can take questions about the test at the end. I'll talk a little bit about Teach Next Year. So I can go to the next slide. Thank you. So this is really exciting. Next year, well, starting this summer, we will be partnering with UMass Boston and their Teach Next Year program to have a Lawrence cohort. Teach Next Year is an urban teaching residency program. It was originally started in the Boston Public Schools in partnership with UMass Boston, has a history of recruiting diverse candidates. And overall, they have a 5-year retention rate of 76% of their graduates still teaching in urban schools 5 years later. It's a one-year accelerated master's degree in education in conjunction with a school placement. So what that looks like is an aspiring teacher is spending the entire school day and school year in a Lawrence public school, and then in the evenings they're taking courses to get their master's. A one-year accelerated master's program is very rare to find, especially for teaching. That they're more likely to be 2 to 3 years. So this is really exciting. They also focus on high needs areas, so they duly license all of their candidates in either special education or ESL. So teachers graduating from this program will have, for example, a 5 through 12 math license as well as an English as a second language license. It's also incredibly reduced cost. The entire master's costs the participant between $7,000 and $11,000, whereas typical master's programs are closer to $22,000. Educators can also submit for reimbursement through the district for a portion of that, so it will actually end up being even more reduced.
And these are teacher candidates that are at UMass Boston?
No, I'll talk about that right on the next slide. So in Lawrence, what the partnership is going to look like is we will be placing 8 to 20 of these candidates, Teach Next Year residents in Lawrence, across any school that's interested, with a focus on middle and high school. Those are our high needs recruitment areas. The majority of courses will take place in Lawrence. They may have to travel to Boston, to UMass Boston, to take one course. And the priority here is to actively recruit our current paraprofessionals and support staff, so BBEs, long-term subs, any type of support staff who's interested in becoming a full-time teacher, to get them to enroll in the program. So they would remain in their current position. If they're a paraprofessional at one of our schools, they would just add on a few responsibilities. They would have a mentor teacher. They would take this coursework and then graduate in 1 year. So our priority are current LPS employees, and I'll talk a little bit about where the interest has been. There is also the opportunity for folks in the community who would like to become a teacher, might not already work in a school, but we've had some interested Lawrence residents who are not currently LPS employees. There's also a pathway for them, so they could enter and become a Teach Next Year resident and go through this program as well. So where are we right now? 18 principals have expressed interest in hosting this program. So they said, this sounds great. I have staff members that I think would be wonderful for this program. Over 35 current LPS employees, mix of aides, some school safety officers, paraprofessionals, BBEs, have indicated interest and attended our information session in December. And the next step is their applications to UMass Boston are due March 15th, and then we work with UMass Boston to select the candidates and work with them moving forward. They would start courses in the summer. Really what we're hoping to achieve through this program, the first thing is obviously the biggest priority for me, but one of our four priorities. We have 31 to 32% of our students are classified as English language learners. All teachers teach these students. We really need all teachers to have the expertise around English as a second language, ESL, and the dually certification option is really positive. And that goes for special education as well, the fact that they dually certify in special education. And then in terms of focusing on our current employees, we are hoping to employ more teachers who live in Lawrence, and 60% of our paraprofessionals live in Lawrence currently. We're also hoping to increase the diversity of our teacher workforce, and over 60% of our paraprofessionals are Hispanic. So those are our overarching goals for the program. We're really excited about it. It will be a pilot year and hopefully be very successful. I'm happy to answer any questions about either topic.
I have a question.
Mr.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You mentioned earlier pertaining to the yells on the neighboring towns. I completely missed that portion. So you mentioned whether or not it impacts the city or doesn't impact the city, or you
were I was just referencing we are what's called a high incidence district with the percentage of English language learners that we have.
Okay.
There might be a neighboring district that has 6 English language learners in their entire district, so this test doesn't impact them as greatly, whereas for us, we have many students, over 100 students in each school taking this test. So just kind of anecdotally speaking to the impact it has for us.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Ms. Rivera?
What type of exam is the access exam, and does it differentiate the difference between receptive language development and expressive language development?
Yes, so it's a language proficiency exam that has 4 domains, and actually the scores, if you look on page 2, when they report out the scores, they actually have a few different combinations they report out that accounts for both receptive and expressive language. So the student will get an oral language score, a literacy score, a comprehension score, and an overall score. So they will take a listening and reading test to test their receptive language, and they will also do a speaking and a writing test to do their expressive language.
How long does it take to get the results back?
That changes every year, but they take it in January, February, and the results are projected May 31st of this year.
Okay. Is there a reason why it's done in January and February versus the beginning of the school year? Because I just feel like if the exam is used to assess their progress and to see if they're eligible for a different placement outside the ELL program, wouldn't it be better to do that assessment in the beginning of the year?
So we do an intake assessment for all students at the beginning of the year, at the beginning of their time with us, that's aligned to this. It's developed by the same consortium, the WIDA consortium. That's called the WIDA Access Placement Test, mm-hmm. which is a separate test. And then our ESL teachers also do diagnostics at the beginning of the year. In general, the timing that the window of the test administration isn't ideal, January, February. Because it also doesn't monitor the progress they might make from the end of the testing window through the end of the school year.
In regards to the Teach Next Year program, I know that there's a reduced cost of tuition, but in, you know, advertising that program, are you also letting teachers aware of the Teachers Loan Forgiveness program? So if they do enroll in the program at a low cost tuition, they also have the potential to get their student loans forgiven?
Yes, and UMass, that was a part of the December 6th information session that we held for teachers. UMass Boston has a few different grants and the loan forgiveness program, as well as our in-district tuition reimbursement that we introduced, and we'll keep following up with candidates once they're accepted into the program.
Thank you.
Yep.
Anyone else? Good?
All set.
I think Ms. the Vice Chair has a question.
All set.
I'm sorry. Here.
That's all right.
So close.
I know, so close and yet so far. You said that there were, you're projecting 8 to 20 candidates for next year, and you currently have, what, 30?
We have over 35 who have expressed interest.
Okay. Do you think you'll take all of them from our current employees, or will you reach out to Lawrence residents that are interested?
So, first of all, the 8 through 20 is a self-imposed threshold. It's not something, if we have more than 20, that would be great. We can accept as many as we want in terms of current employees. So if we had a cohort of 30, that would be wonderful. We were just trying to be realistic about how many people we might have in the program. But prior to our information session in December, we did also put flyers around and give flyers to local community organizations to try and recruit those who might be outside of the school system. And many of those people attended the December 6th information session as well.
So if somebody outside the district wants to be part of this program, is it the district's responsibility to give them an assignment in a school, a position?
So if you're coming from outside of our system, it would be more of a traditional teacher resident or internship model where you would receive a stipend, but it would not be the same as staying in your current salaried position and being able to do it. So the benefits, while really great for both groups, obviously are really, really highlighted for our current employees.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Foley. Okay, as the board requested, we asked Mr. Fiato to come up again. He's been with us one or two times already this year, and he'll be back again, I think, later in the spring, but just to update folks on the high school redesign process. Welcome, Mr. Fiato.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for having me again. I think I was here in November, provided a brief update. I'd like to do the same this evening. As you all know, over the course of the past 2 years, Lawrence High School has been involved in a redesign, moving from six individual siloed high schools to more of a comprehensive campus. And as you know, over the 14-15 school year, we had integration of a ninth grade academy. Last year was a 10th grade academy. And our next challenge is to look at what the configuration of the upper school model will look like. As I promised, we would have stakeholder focus groups to inform the process, similar to what we did in over the last 2 years. So we're in our third year of really soliciting feedback from all of our stakeholders, including students, families, teachers, administrators, and business and higher ed, to explore what the upper school redesign should look like, and what are the key elements and necessary components to ensure that our students are college and career ready. Although we're not prepared yet to provide you with a overview of what the upper school redesign will look like in terms of organizational structures, there are a few key components that we know will be non-negotiables that will happen because of the overwhelming input that we've received from the community, from the stakeholders, from our staff, from our students, and the things that they feel that they need to see at the high school in order for them to be successful in high school and upon graduation. We've listed a few of those things here. I'll just go over them really quickly. One of the overarching concerns from some of our families and students was that we're not doing enough around college and career pathway models or exposure to industries and exposure to different careers. So we take that very seriously. So we're looking at some different potential models that would ensure that students have exposure to industry themes in career fields while they're at the high school. As you can see, as you saw in our previous, one of the first presentations was the internship program. So that would continue to grow, and we'll continue to develop programs like that at the high school. We're looking at some early college and dual enrollment options. So we currently have had an awesome relationship with Northern Nexus Community College, and we're looking to expand that so that students have access to early college opportunities at the high school level while they're in school. All the studies show that if students have access to college credits while they're in school, the chances of them receiving a four-year degree increases incrementally. So we feel that that's an important component of the high school redesign. Especially for juniors and seniors, looking at a flexible schedule for internships to allow for movement around the campus. Currently, if the student has to if they're on track to graduate, we want to provide them with some earned autonomy and ability to engage in some of those experiences that they would have in college, especially for our upper school students. So our internship students, as you saw, they get a chance to leave the campus. They have a pass, and they're able to leave the campus when they go to their internships. And they've been great and very responsible with that. So we want to be able to give those students who deserve that responsibility that opportunity. As we've done over the past few years, continue to expand our access to advanced placement and other campus-wide courses. Going from a silo to a system, we have more opportunities for students to have a wide range of electives and a wide range of classes, as opposed to just having classes in there in one particular building. And our students really appreciated that. But at the same time, we want to make sure that our students have a personalized experience. So if we go from a small learning community, small individual high school, and open it back up to a big campus model, how do we make sure that we don't lose students to dropouts? How do we make sure we personalize the experience? So we're talking about making sure that we have cohort models where a small group of teachers have access and responsible for a smaller group of students, while opening up the school to while opening up the students to having more access to the elective courses. One big piece, and I talked about this at the last meeting, were advisory and seminar classes, which are more provides the teachers and students to get to know each other really well and more like a homeroom environment. But we have a prescribed curriculum where there are college and career readiness tasks that students can complete, such as making sure they complete their FAFSA, making sure they do their college application, making sure that they have visited a college, are looking at opportunities to for community service. So these are those soft skills that often get overlooked at the high school level because we're hyper focused on academics, which is great, but we have to give our students opportunities to engage in some real world activities, because we want them to be not only great students, but we also want them to be great citizens of the city and great citizens of the community. So we provide them with those opportunities in an advisory, and we want to do that from 9 to 12 so that all students have those opportunities. I think I skipped over interdisciplinary planning. So if we allow our teachers time to plan together, they'll have opportunities to not only infuse some career and industry themes, but they'll get to know their students really well. So they'll be having weekly meetings to talk about instruction, but also to discuss the students that are in front of them every single day, again, to get to know their students well and personalize the learning experience. And one thing we know for sure, we have to continue to look at ways to increase support for our most at-risk students, those students who are at risk of dropping out, those students who are falling behind cohort. And we're looking at different models that we can use on the campus, whether it be during the school day or even after school in the Twilight program, to provide opportunities for students who may be falling behind and may need a more non-traditional approach. All of this redesign work is grounded in working with some parallel planning with the NEASC accreditation process. And so the New England Association of Schools and Colleges is an institution that we belong to at Lawrence High School. Most colleges in New England and high schools in New England, even public and private, subject themselves to the accreditation process. It's every 10 years. And we believe that we're ready for the accreditation process, which was happening in the spring of 2019. And all of that work will inform and be considered as we work on our redesign process. So we're basically saying we'll be hosting a group of educators from the New England area. They'll probably have to be around 20 to 30 because the campus is so big, that will come in and basically rate us on 7 standards, and the standards are in front of you. And they basically will tell us how well we're doing in relation to the standards at the high school, grades 9 to 12. So we're really excited to get the feedback from our partners. We think from the accreditation process, we think we're gonna do well. We're in the planning phases now. Next year, we embark on a self-study, which basically means the faculty will rate themselves according to these standards, and then we'll produce a report, which we will share with you. And we also provide it to the NEASC so that they will consider it. And then they'll come in the spring of 2019 and provide a report on the progress that we've made towards accreditation. So what I think we could do, maybe in the coming months, is I would love to come back and provide you with a more detailed overview of what the upper school redesign looks like, and I can continue to give you an update on NEASC. I think that's about it. I would like to take some questions. I'm sure you have some. And I can take some questions now.
So just to jump in, the team that comes from NEASC could be as big as 20 to 30 people.
Oh, of course, yeah. I've been on visiting teams. I've been on 3 visits myself: Brockton, Cambridge, and Lowell. And those are some of the bigger high schools. And we had over 22 visitors because of the size of the school. And each of the team members have to break up onto a committee. So they divide by 3 to 4 to a committee. And they're responsible to assess the standard that they're responsible for.
Good. So they get lay people to do this. So it's not
they're
just like
principals, teachers, guidance counselors.
Sent our teachers out to be on some of these committees and to actually help accredit other high schools so they know the process.
We have I don't know the number, but a very robust amount of teachers have gone to these visits over the last 2 to 3 years, and more will be going in the coming years to ready ourselves for the visit. Because there's nothing like going through the process yourself to really know what the schools are looking, what the accreditation process is looking for.
And then the second piece is, this goes to the overall report. How close have you and the superintendent have kept the commissioner? Because I know he was really specific about this one piece, about the high school redesign and its timeliness and its effectiveness. And I'd hate to get to the other side of the redesign.
I meet with the commissioner every other week, and so he is briefed about the high school redesign every other week. Okay. And he'll be coming later in the spring to address this board, too.
Interesting.
One of the other key points that I did want to make is that I'll be meeting with teachers, students, faculty, administrators over the coming weeks to present some different models that would be kind of that are generated from these key components to determine which models would be the most salient at the high school campus. And then we will come back with the superintendent and with your permission to present the final decision.
Great. Mrs. Mariano?
Mike, in your focus groups that met in December, I believe you had a schedule in December, did community members participate?
Yes.
And could you tell me, you know, who were the representatives?
So we had PTO members, Lawrence High School parents were the majority of the representatives.
What about businesses in the area?
We didn't have any representatives from this last focus group, but we, over the previous 2 years, we had business focus groups that provided us with some very important and timely information around some of the gaps that they think some of our students have around college and career readiness and accessibility to the workforce. So we still have a lot of that information that we've collected. We also conducted a community survey that was online, and we got responses from a wide range of stakeholders that included business.
And the Lawrence Partnership has jumped in, not for the accreditation necessarily, but for the internships. And Derek Mitchell and his crew with all the different businesses from GenLine to Sal, they're all jumping in to help.
That was going to be my point, where you have businesses involved in the internship. Should they also be involved in the focus group and have a say in what this redesign looks like?
Well, the feedback that we get now is even more authentic, because they see what our students are bringing to the table, the strengths and also the things that we need to work on as a school. To address any of the gaps that we may have, and to strengthen the 4-year education that they receive, so that when they go to these internships, they can be value added. So we are getting some good feedback. We meet with the business partners regularly to get that feedback.
Thank you.
Ms. Rivera?
I think I recall hearing, or I don't know if it was at one of the meetings or from a student, that the library at the high school, that we're going to get rid of it to expand the Abbott Academy. Is that true?
The library is still in existence. It has been, some space is being used for the Abbott expansion that was created. We added 4 new classrooms over the course of the summer, which did encroach upon some of the library, but we have... we were just talking about media services today, and we really want to look at maintaining text in the library, so there are textbooks and books that students can take out. We added a conference room that staff and students can use. We added laptops for students to take out in the library with Wi-Fi, so if a student needs to do a project, they can go in and do research on their own, on the school laptops that are connected to wireless, that are connected to printers. And we have a lot of activity in the learning commons. We call it the learning commons, from about 7 in the morning to about 6 at night. And it's used heavily throughout the day and at lunches. Students seek refuge there. They don't want to be in the cafeteria. They can go there and use the library. So it is, we were blessed with a very big space to begin with. Not to say that it wouldn't be great to have a big space for this, but I think we use what we have very, very well. And we're going to continue to find ways to make sure that we have a combination of text and also high-tech support and services for our students and staff.
And you mentioned textbooks, and I remember last year when I got to visit the 9th grade academy, we noticed that students in the biology class didn't have access to textbooks. They couldn't bring one home. They had packets of homework printed out for them. Do they have access to textbooks now? Are they each assigned a textbook, or what's the status of that?
There's various levels of classes that have textbooks. In that particular case, we last year those students didn't have math textbooks. They were using packets. So I don't know about the bio, and I can check, but I know that we've added ELA text, history text, and math text. But I can double check for you on the bio for sure. And that's something that we feel is very important. Many of our students have access to technology at home, and the textbook companies are very modernized now, where they provide the resources right online. So we're able to kind of navigate, the students navigate a combination of online, teacher-generated, and textbooks. So you may see some classes that do not have textbooks, but rest assured that all of our coursework is Common Core aligned, and that students have either readers or access to a textbook in the classroom if they don't have one.
And just to follow up with that real quick, there was a snafu with the purchasing process on books this year, coming into this year, if I remember, feels like it was this year, right? It was this year, in which not only at the high school, but in other places too, the manner in which the procurement was happening was not, done the way that would have made things a lot easier. So it got behind. And so the purchasing process finally aligned, and then the books have come in since. But for the most part, it was really about making sure we weren't running afoul of the state purchasing laws and regulations. That doesn't make anybody feel good, but the bureaucrats are happy.
Okay. any final questions for Headmaster?
Thank you.
I have.
Mrs. Marianne.
Mike, I have one final question. It's in reference to a request I had at the last meeting. Did you have the opportunity as yet to evaluate your crisis plan?
We evaluate the crisis plan monthly. We have a crisis meeting every month.
In response to the crisis that you had at the high school last fall?
Absolutely. We've done a postvention survey and had opportunities to revisit how we handled that situation with the input from the staff and input from our community partners who are integral in providing support and services to the teachers.
Now, is any of that information available to us?
Through Anne Marie Stronach and Dr. Bergeron, I think we can provide a report that we've created with Dr. Ann Hall, our school psychologist, around the way we handled the situation and some lessons learned, and also some things that we did really well.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else?
Negative.
Thanks.
Before heading to public participation, any final questions, Mayor?
Nope.
Okay.
Oh, one second. Hold on.
I'm sorry.
It's okay,
Ms. Mariano.
Is there any way, Superintendent, that we could consider the location of our next meeting and probably have it over at the Family Resource Center? I think historically, if we look, we don't have any parents or very few parents here at our meetings, and I think we're doing a disservice by not making it accessible to parents. And they seem, you know, based on their meetings that they have there, the meetings are very, very well attended.
Yes.
Can we revisit that maybe one more time to see if we have parents and that are willing to come to a school committee meeting at that location?
Sure. As people know, the President's Council, which is the presidents of each school's PTO, meets with me on a regular basis at the Family Resource Center, and that is a very well-attended event. I mean, we have standing room only oftentimes. And we'd be happy to move the meeting in February to FRC. But remember, it is tight in there, but we're happy to do it. And we can work with Denise to try to get some of our PTO parents to come, if you'd like.
You know, as far as the outreach goes, how are we outreaching to the schools to let them know when our meetings are and that parents are invited to come?
Sure. We're happy to do that. I think I don't want to disparage the parents in any way, shape, or form, because that group is a very viable organization. The mayors come to speak to them, and I give them much of the information, if not all of the information, that you guys get. So they are well invested in and into the process, certainly. But we could certainly move the meeting there and invite folks to come. It would be great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Superintendent.
Okay, we have one speaker for public participation today. Mr. Molly, are you here, sir? Welcome. We'll remind you, we have 2 minutes, and Joan will give you the 30 seconds to go time at the 1 minute 30 mark.
Also, be sure to address your comments to the committee as a whole and not any individual committee member.
Good evening, honorable members. The year 2017, parent and citizen are proud of our public school accomplishment. Our public school has become the best model of success. Grateful to impeccable leadership of Honorable Superintendent Raleigh, the hero that saved Lawrence Public School. Now with more high school graduates, more MCAS improvement, City of Immigrant has risen up with the hope of best future for our children. Success of turnaround plan lighten up our public school. Our proud teachers must know 83,000 citizens support their hard work and their proud union. We move forward with the best parent resource center with the best student-focused budget. May the year of 2017 be another shining year in the history of our public school. Our hard-working teachers and their union turnaround plan has brought success to Lawrence Public School. Let's move forward in the year 2017. We cannot forget the past. Every day since arrival of Superintendent Raleigh, the positive impact of the turnaround plan put our public school one of the best public school in the nation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Marley. Before asking you to close, Mr. Mayor, I just want to point out in people's packets, I think we put Massachusetts Association of School Committees flyer for a meeting in March that talks about education and how it intersects with poverty. If folks have a chance to attend, I think it's going to be an important meeting to discuss the effects of poverty on students and what that does. So I just wanted to make that informational and point it out to you as a group. If you did not get it, we will email it to you.
Is anyone from the district already planning on going to this?
We're going to send district people as well. Yeah, right. I may be going myself. School Committee Association is partnering with the School Committee Association, Superintendents Association, and School Committee Association are partnering together to put this on.
Cool. Thanks. And well, if folks need to go, want to go together, maybe we'll do something with the school board to do that.
Okay.
Cool. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Motion's been made. Is there a second?
I second that.
Motion been made. Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
All right. The ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you.